And it came to pass that when Rabbi Israel Baal Shem Tov felt he was about to die, he summoned his disciples, and when they all were gathered around him, he asked them not to give in sadness. In heaven, he said, I shall do whatever I can to hasten the coming of the Messiah. Needless to say, he meant what he promised. And he, of course, pledged himself to keep that promise. As soon as his soul reached heaven, he expressed the desire to meet the Redeemer. His wish, after all, it was the Baal Shem Tov, was granted. But the encounter provoked in the Baal Shem Tov such exaltation, such ecstasy, that he forgot his promise. This tale and this defeat was known also to his successor, the Maggid of Meseritch, who also wanted his disciples present during his last hours. He too promised them to precipitate events and put an end to man's suffering. So, to dispose of him, the angels turned him into one of them, and he too forgot what he owed the people below. I shall not let it happen to me, promised Levi Yitzchak of Berdichev. I shall succumb to no temptation and submit to no offer. I shall refuse to enter paradise. I shall tell the judges of all judges, the being of all beings. I shall tell him what his duties are towards his creation and his children. Well, the Berdichev, when he came to heaven, did stir up much noise and did oppose resistance to all the angels and seraphim. And, as legend goes, they had to use force to make him enter paradise. Don't worry, said Rabbi Israel of Rizhin, or as we call him, the Rizhiner. And he is the one who told us this tale. Do not worry, I tell you. I shall resist better and longer. I shall not forget. Unfortunately, it appears that he couldn't keep his promise either. What does this legend tell us? That he was a very proud man. Tonight, we shall try and explore the legends about him. Those few of you who have been with us from the very beginning of our walk through the Pardes HaChassidut, the orchard of the Hasidic movement, will remember that until now we tried to describe extraordinary characters. The solitary man of Kotsk who tried to reach God through anger. We talked about Rabbi Nachman of Bratslav, the Kafka of Hasidism, who tried to achieve perfection through imagination and art. We tried to speak about the Baal Shem Tov and the Meseritcher Maggid and their urge to establish disciples. Tonight, it is a complete different character we are going to explore. He resembles to none of them. For one reason, he was much less learned than them. If I were not afraid of my Rebbe, who used to be the Vizhnitsa Rebbe, and the Vizhnitsa Rebbe is a descendant of the Rizhiner, I would say that the Rizhiner was very close to be an Amoritz. But an Amoritz in those times Yes, tonight we shall try to evoke his image and his imprint on the Hasidic movement. It is his tale we shall attempt to transmit, a disturbing tale, both beautiful and deceptively simple. A tale which marks the beginning and the end of an era in the life of Hasidism. After him, the movement was no longer the same. After him came the inevitable process of decline, of getting away farther and farther from the source and from innocence as well. It happens always, and wherever man in his impulse for self-purification attempts to transcend his destiny and accepts responsibility for a world he has not created, which is the substance of Judaism. Man takes a step forward, stretches out his hand to a friend, a companion, to a stranger, perhaps, to enable them to cross the abyss. He refuses mediocrity, rejects ugliness, vulgarity, fights absurdity by imposing a sense, a meaning to it, defines himself as revolutionary and is ready and willing to fight the whole universe and its mighty rulers and captains and princes. If he fails, it's all right. He becomes a martyr. But woe unto him who succeeds. Nothing corrupts revolutions more and more radically than success. For there follows a second generation and a third, less and less idealistic. For a while it fights out of habit or even inertia. Eventually, it turns its fight inwards, dividing itself into all kinds of factions, groups, and sects, each one against the other, and each one against all, with substance giving way to form, to superficiality. Ideas are replaced by personalities. It's an unavoidable process. No surprise is eternal, no passion immortal. At dawn, night has lost its promise, its poetic impact. No revolutionary movement has ever succeeded in maintaining alive its initial inspiration and transmitting the vision and thirst of its first builders. Nothing is harder to maintain than to maintain the dream after it has succeeded in molding reality. Swift victories, even those of the spirit, may prove dangerous. I believe that if Moses decided to lead the Jews through the desert for 40 long years, it was perhaps because he wanted to preserve the authenticity of their first victory over the Egyptians. One does not win battles with impunity. No fulfillment is possible without paying some kind of a price. And the price is usually one's own innocence. All this has been illustrated by most revolutionary movements, including those in Russia, where Stalinism replaced communism, in China, where Mao Zedong's debilitating red book has become the last word of Chinese wisdom, as well as in art and political science and other fields, where first discoveries, which are pure and often beautiful, provoke ultimately spiritual downfall, and in a way, on a much different level, lehavdil elef alfei havdalot, this has also been illustrated by what happened to Hasidism. The story of Rabbi Israel Rijiner can therefore serve both as an example and a warning. Hence, its relevancy. Born in 1797, Israel Rijgener was Hasidism's favorite child. He was also its last undisputed leader. His authority was never contested or even questioned. Was it because he was the grandson of the great-grandson of the Magid of Meseritz, the hero of our last talk? Perhaps, but he did enjoy a special status, immune to criticism. He seemed to evoke special memories, special longings and dreams, rather than achievements. People loved him without even knowing why, without even trying to know why. He was accepted, admired, adopted, cherished, forgiven, but not understood. People used to say later that no one understood the Rijgener, but to this day, we don't know whether this was meant as a compliment or. His taste for solitude, his taste for luxury, his lack of scholarship and erudition, his pride, his new derech, his new way of life, so different from that of other masters and of Judaism as such, but so different of the early masters of Hasidism, of whom he was a descendant. Rijgin in Hasidism means Malchut Israel, the royalty of Israel, or the sphere of Tiferet in Kabbalah. Rijgin signifies glory and its external symbols discarded by Hasidism and Judaism and until then. Already as a child, and he was a spoiled child, the future Rijgener behaved like a prince in exile, entitled to honors and privileges not known. I quote, "At the age of 7, he said, I visited Vienna and was accorded such a welcome by so many people of all walks of life that I am no longer impressed today. Nothing but the best was good enough for him. His elegant and somewhat modern suits, tailor-made, were an astonishment. He was very handsome, according to tradition, and very rich. And from the very beginning, there was in him a love for riches, but also a love for beauty. In later years, he had a palace with servants, orchestras, and horse stables. No races. His synagogue in Sadigora could accommodate 3,000 worshippers. He would never go anywhere without an entourage of 100 or so aides, cooks, and court favorites and musicians. Rijgen was a temple and Rabbi Israel its royal presence. Nothing was too expensive for the Rijgener. On Passover, we know, his guests were served in golden dishes. Every Shabbat brought another attempt to recreate lost splendors from Jerusalem before its destruction. The singing was reminiscent of the singing of the Levi'im, the Levites, the meals of the service at the altar, and people by the thousands converged upon Rijgen and later Sadigor, simply to be in Rijgen and Sadigor, simply to see the prince in his palace, the prince on his throne, the prince and his wealth. And strange as it may sound, nobody was shocked. Nobody was scandalized. He, the Rijgener, was above complaints, beyond judgment. There were great masters among those who came to see him. Reb Hersh Rimanover, Reb Itche Meyer of Ger, the Chidushei Harim, Reb Itzik Lworke, Reb Chaim Ulzanzer, the Gaon HaTorah, a genius of Talmud and Halacha, and even Shamshon Raphael Hirsch, who was very far from Hasidism, among many, many others. None lifted an eyebrow. All were charmed, and all went away not convinced, but won over. No one criticized the Rishoner. Why? What is the mystery about him? What were his powers? We shall try to find it out. Naturally, all those who came to see him in Rizhin or in Sadigor realized how different his Hasidism was from their own, different from the one they had received from their masters. Once upon a time in Mezebish, in the Baal Shem Tov's times, or in Mezerich, in Berdichev, in Chernobyl, the Hasid had tried to conquer poverty using means other than money, to defeat sadness using means other than a cappella of musicians. Hasidism then made it a point to fight appearances and mock comfort. The Baal Shem Tov was so poor that he had nothing to eat mishabbat le Shabbat, and so were his immediate disciples. And they advocated joy within misery, hope despite misfortune, faith in spite of injustice. They advocated warmth and generosity in one's relation with another, and severity, extreme severity, with oneself. Once upon a time, Hasidism meant a compulsion to emphasize clarity, simplicity, inner truth, and knowledge, and dvekut, and fervor. It meant then a return to nature, to genuine beauty, to identification. A Hasid would see a tree and became that tree. He would hear the song of the shepherds and became that song. That was his way of getting closer to creation and to the Creator and to man and to the source of life and truth. He did not need castles and servants to feel at home in God's world. Possessions meant nothing. Only being was important. What did the Baal Shem Tov teach his followers, if not that beggars may be princes in disguise, and that fools may be messengers or wandering prophets linking man to his past and his past to that of other men? We have tried in all of our talks to emphasize that point, that man, through Hasidism, and in a larger sense through the Judaic tradition, tried to be God's partner by being man's friend. So Hasidism then became the abolition before becoming a presence, the abolition between man and man, and world, and word and silence and song. But in Rizhin, and later in Sadigor, what was glorified was the mask, not the face, the mirror, and not the secret left unrevealed by the mirror. The question then would be, why? Why did Rabbi Israel of Rizhin establish such a system so contradictory to whatever we know about Judaism? What did he aim to discover, to refute, or simply to prove? What play, what fantasy was acted out in Rizhin, In what code was it written? Which were the symbols involved? He could have been criticized for his affluence, for the social gap between him and his supporters, but he was not. I would criticize him today, being a Vizhnitzer Hasid. These poor Jews were so poor, and they came from so far, from all the corners of their land, and brought their poor pidyon, their poor money, which they earned with the sweat of their work, and brought him who needed none of their monies. He could have been, should have been opposed and challenged on the grounds that his extravaganza was bordering apparent heresy within Hasidic terms of reference. But he was not. He was free to do whatever he wanted, the way he wanted. As a founder of a dynasty, if not of a school of thought, he seemed to be protected, untouchable, untouched. It is said that when Rabbi Avraham Yoshua Heschel of Abt proclaimed a day of fasting and prayer, Etanit Tzibur, out of solidarity with a certain Jewish community in distress, on that same day the Rishoner summoned his musicians to play for him. Yet the Abt Rebbe, called Ohev Israel, the most famous, the senior among the tzaddikim then, was not really offended. He remarked, and I quote, "No one can understand the ways and the methods of the Rishoner." True, no one can. Other rabbis adopted the same attitude. Even the Kotzke Rebbe, so strong, so fierce, somehow accepted that the Rishoner, whatever he does, perhaps he has a reason and the right to do so. All of them agreed, out of respect rather than complacency. He was simply above reproach. He was a rabbi unlike others, a special case, a destiny in itself, not to be measured by the usual standards. But why, again, why such favoritism? Why such privileges? Riches is not really anti-Jewish. Some Jews, not of my best friends, are rich. Even the Talmud, Rabbi was very rich, and the trouble is Rabbi Mechabed Ashirim Haya. He respected rich. But what made the Rishoner so special? Only because of his chut avot, because of the Mezevitcher Magid? Or was it because he represented almost from the very beginning a real force, almost today we would say a political force, within the movement, a force that other leaders had to reckon with? Or was there something else? And if so, what was it? I'm afraid I must confess, I don't know. I don't understand how humble and learned figures, the Worker Rebbe and the Gerer Rebbe, could go along with his lack of scholarship and his accent on aristocracy and its earthly attributes. Nor do I understand his own self-indulgence, his lack of restraint, and his lack of self-criticism. Or, to put it mildly, his exhibitionism. Perhaps he really did aim to accomplish something, and we shall try to return to it later. For the moment, let us speak about his followers, whose number increased from day to day, from month to month. Thanks to him, the Hasidic movement had made new headway and reached into forsaken Jewish communities struggling for survival. His legend captivated the masses. His biography was enriched. Popular imagination attributed to him innumerable qualities and powers. wrong. Some disciples claimed, and they referred their source as himself, that his soul was among the four Moses had brought back from heaven together with the Torah. The other three being Noblesse Oblige, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, who wrote the Zohar, Rabbi Yitzhak Luri, the founder of the Lurianic Kabbalah, and Rabbi Yisrael Bar Shem Tov, the founder of Hasidism. The Rishoner himself said that he had been on earth three times before. The first time as a young prince in the kingdom of Judea, a prince. The second time as a young priest in the temple, not Halila Levi, a priest. And now was the third time. The old Apter Rebbe already quoted bore witness that the Rishoner's wisdom and knowledge were given to him directly from heaven. And the Rishoner naturally couldn't but agree with him. I quote, "I," said the Rishoner, "was brought up as an orphan. Therefore, I received the Torah directly from God's hands." Perhaps that explains why he refused to study. His tutor always complained, as we know from Hasidic tradition, about his unwillingness to read books. A man with such relations does not need teachers and could do without their teachings. It also explains his lack of education. Yet even that was overlooked and forgiven when he was 5 or 15, according to the source, his girdle, his ritual belt, slipped and fell on the floor, and the old Apter Rebbe picked it up and put it around the young man's waist, murmuring, "It is like accomplishing the commandment of Galilah, of rolling together the Torah, the scrolls of the Torah." Well, the spoiled child of Hasidism remained spoiled to the end. In truth, the Rishoner felt so sure of himself that he thought he didn't have to study. Whatever words he uttered became interesting and important, to say the least. To Rabbi Moshe of Savran, a famous rabbi and scholar who came for a visit, the Rishoner showed with pride his stable and spoke with vanity and satisfaction of his magnificent horses. When the Rabbi Moshe of Savran left the Rishoner, all he could say as a commentary was, I quote, "Oh, you didn't understand. The whole talk of horses was nothing but an allegory. In truth, the Rishoner discussed Maasei Merkava, a mystical concept for God's mysterious work in heaven and in history." His more formal speeches, though very rare, were never particularly erudite. Even his most ardent admirers agree that he helped his followers not with study or prayer, but with the tales he told them or made them tell. So what was Hasidism a la Rishon made of? It was based upon three principles. Joy, emunat tzadikim, called faith in the tzadik, and tahavat Israel, love for Jews, which in a broader context, as always, signified love for mankind. So his Hasidim had absolute faith in him. One man named the Bianchev Yosef of Koretz told him once of his plans to move to a remote village and serve there a school teacher. What? Exclaimed the regioner. Another teacher? Or as he said it in Yiddish, and his stories must be told in Yiddish, he said, was? Noch a Dorf melamed? No, he says, you won't become a teacher. It is time for you to become rich. Already then, the regioner, who was very clever, understood that from teaching, one does not become rich. But so strong was poor Yankev Yosef's faith that he began doing business and became immensely rich. Was that the regioner's strength? To push his people to self-fulfillment? Maybe. But then, why did he need luxury, his own luxury, to do that? The Baal Shem Tov in his wooden sack provoked more inner changes and deeper ones. But then the Baal Shem Tov had less disciples, less admirers, and all poor. May I remind you of a story that I have told here 3 years ago? The story told by the Kotzke Rebbe. The Kotzke, we won't come back to him, but he was probably the greatest personage, the greatest character in Hasidism. Relevant today because of his behavior, because of his protest, because of imagination, and also because of his artistic approach to life and to art. Every writer and every artist experiences his anguish. What is the story? One day, Reb Itzhak Walker, who was one of the three people who were permitted to come in to see him during his confinement, which lasted 20 years. The bicycle worker came in and he said, Shalom Aleichem, Rebbe, peace unto you, in good English. So the Kotzke Rebbe says, don't call me Rebbe. But Rebbe, you are a Rebbe. Don't call me Rebbe. I am not a rabbi, said the Kotzke. Don't you see what I am? I am the holy goat. Let me tell you the story of the holy goat. Once upon a time, he says, there was a Jew who had a snuff box. This Jew went for a walk in the forest and lost his snuff box. So he began to cry. But just then it happened that the Holy Goat was around. Who is the Holy Goat? The Holy Goat, says the Kotzke, is roaming around the world from morning to midnight. For at midnight it is its task with its horns to steer the stars and move them to sing the glory of God. So when the Holy God, when the Holy Goat, not being human, felt some compassion for a Jew, said, why are you crying? And he said, I lost my snuff box. That's all? Do you have a knife? Yes, I have a knife. Take your knife, cut a piece of my horn, and you'll have a snuff box, which the Jew did. Shabbos, he came to the synagogue, and he took out his snuff box, as is the custom, while they were reading the Torah, and snuffed. But the aroma was so exquisite. There was something so heavenly about it that all of them converged upon him, for God, the creator Torah, and said, where did you buy this tobacco? He said, it's not a tobacco, it's the box. Where did you buy the box? I didn't buy it. Where did you get it? He told them. So as soon as Shabbat ended, all the Jews of the synagogue took their knives, ran to the forest, found the holy goat, and each man cut a little piece of the horn for a snuffbox. Finally, the holy goat remained with no horn. Says the Kotzka that since then, the holy goat is still roaming the roads of the world from morning to midnight. But at midnight, it can no longer stir with its horns the stars to sing the glory of God and of night. All it can do is look up to the stars and feel a very profound nostalgia. Don't you see, says the Kotzka, I am the holy goat. There is something in every artist afraid to give if one gives. What do we have? Maybe we give too much. Well, the Kotzka didn't want disciples. Perhaps he was afraid. The Rishner wanted disciples and wanted admirers. I don't know whether he saw himself as the holy goat, but his snuffbox, you may be sure of that, was a golden one. But then comes the next question, and it's even more startling. Why did the poor people love the Rishner? What attracted them to the Rishner? Did they see in him a possibility of, say, a personality transfer, of sublimation? The fact that they liked him, worshipped him, proves they needed someone like him to admire and idolize. They needed to believe that it was possible for Jews to live like princes, even in exile, even in the cold region of Russia. In their eyes, he was a reflection of past grandeur, a continuation of ancient dreams and ancient glories. He reminded them of what there once had been, with so much poverty around them, with so much misery in their heart, in their backyard, so much fear in their heart. It was an uplifting experience to see their tzaddik live under different conditions. He was their illusion, their holiday. He was their Shabbat. On the other hand, they had, of course, to invent some plausible explanation or justification for his originality. So they said, and here you see the beauty of the Hasidic naivete. They said, our Rabbi, poor man, beneath his golden robes, he is wearing a straw dress, like a mourner. And they said, his shoes, so expensive, tailor-made, so elegant, don't look at them. They are without souls. He walks on snow. He suffers, but he did not show it. Actually, in his daily behavior, he encouraged his entourage to think along these lines. He never ate in public. He slept 3 hours a night. He spoke little. He liked to be alone. Avoiding noise, he seemed to be in constant concentration. When Rabbi Uri of Strelitz, the Soreth, died, his Hasidim came to Rishon. A Hasid always needs a Rabbi. Rabbi Israel of Rishon warned them, I quote, if you want to stay, stay, but under one condition, learn to pray in silence. learn to meditate. Don't make much noise. To protect his image, he kept the crowds at a distance, so they would think of him as a saint who did not profit from his precious possessions. If he accepted them, it was only in order to fool Satan, they said. Satan, or the evil spirit, the Yetzer Hara. And they were saying for him, where would Satan go and look for the tzaddik, for the just? In prayer? In the Beit HaMidrash? Certainly, but surely not in the luxurious palace of a prince. Surely not under the expensive garments of someone who seemed not to know much about what is essential in Jewish thought and law. Satan's interest goes to the humble, whom he seeks to corrupt, not the proud, already corrupted. And the reasoner appeared to be proud, just like his father, Reb Sholem Shachmi. The Kotzke Rebbe used to say, I quote, God is where he is allowed to enter. God is dort, wo melostim rein. Reb Sholem Shachmi said, God is dort, wo ich bin. God is where I am. According to legend, the Baal Shem Tov's grandson, the Borochel of Mezebush, offered one day to join forces with him and rule the world. But the Rishoner's father rejected the offer, saying modestly, I don't need you, I can do it alone. His son was not much less egocentrical. He warned people that, I quote, he who speaks evil of me is guilty of blasphemy and will be blackened in this world and the other world. It was dangerous to oppose him. Whoever tried could lose his fortune, his mind, his life. Once he urged the rich businessman to give more to charity. Rabbi, the man objected, I don't mix in your business, please don't mix in mine. I am sure that every rabbi in America heard the same thing at least once in his congregation. But the Rishoner simply answered, no, no, we shall see. And the man went bankrupt. Another version of the same story. If you don't mend your ways, the Rishoner warned the same businessman, you won't stay rich long. Then you won't stay rabbi, said the man who used to be generous with the Rishoner. No, no, said the rabbi, we shall see. And the poor millionaire found out what it meant to be disrespectful and what it meant to be poor again. To his followers who were indulging in Hasidic elbow pushing around him, the Rishoner said, I quote, why must all of you be near me? Isn't it enough to be in the same room with me? Or to be under the same roof, under the same sky? To a child who cried out in disappointment to his father that the Rebbe didn't have six wings like the angels, the Rishoner simply said, but I do have them. I have six sons. They are my angels, my wings. Another version says that he called them the Shisha Sidrei Mishnah, the six books of the Mishnah. Yet, and here comes the most moving part of his life, he was not a happy man. Despite his fame, and despite his enormous wealth and authority he commanded all over Eastern Europe, his life was darkened by tragedy. First of all, a son, Reb Erenyu, the famous Reb Erenyu, Rachmona Litzlan, went astray. Reb Erenyu one day left his home and went to the big town and joined the Maskilim, the anti-Hasidic movement. Then he came back. Legends say he was brought back by force. As for the father earlier, the father spent 22 months in prison. He went through escapes, dramatic escapes through borders smuggled during the night. He faced trials, he experienced tribulations, and carried the weight of generations on his shoulders. Like his father and grandfather, he lived a relatively short life. Of them, he said, they came down, did their work, and went back. Like them, he had to live fast, intensely, and dangerously. Listen to a few biographical details, and you will see the speed of his life. He was engaged at 7. Married at 13. And proclaimed Rebbe at 16. It appears that he did have some aspirations to become himself an angel. For during the first month of his marriage, he refused to come near his wife. And the intervention of the Upper Rebbe was needed to make him perform his duties as husband. Then he lived some 25 years in luxury. He was 40 when he was jailed in Kiev. The reasons for his arrest to this day are not clear. Some sources say he was accused of having pretended to be the king of the Jews. So the Tsar was jealous. Others link his case to the murder of 2 Jewish informers. We know that 80 Jewish dignitaries were taken into custody then, and the reasoner among them. 6 communal leaders were sentenced to 2,000 whiplashes and hard labor for life. One of them, the old Reb Michael Orbach from Dunayevich, was set free during a prison transfer by young Jews who attacked his guards and smuggled him out of the country. While the reasoner was in jail, most often in solitary confinement, his admirers left no stone unturned on his behalf. Governors were bribed. Ministers petitioned and bribed. The Tsar himself was not bribed, but he was approached. Intrigued by so many interventions, the ruler of all the Russians is said to have ordered the reasoner brought before him. The Tsar found that he had the eyes of a revolutionary. I don't know what that means, but that's in the text. So, because he had the eyes of a revolutionary, he left him in jail. The Rebbe then went through stages of depression. We know that he cried often, but never in the presence of visitors. After his release on bail, which he forfeited, he fled illegally with a smuggler's help to Austria, where he adopted the name Friedman. Austria and Turkey offered him citizenship. But he, and this is to his credit, he, for some reason, unexplained, preferred to have in his documents written that he was the citizen of some country that really did not exist as a country. He wanted to be marked in his papers that he is a citizen of Jerusalem. But his troubles were not over yet. The Russian authorities wanted him back, and his case became a huge international affair involving governments on the highest level. Metternich was consulted. The British ambassador had orders to follow developments attentively. St. Petersburg spared no efforts to secure his extradition and failed. The reasoner established in his own estate in Patik near Sadigur, now had influential protectors, because thanks to his presence, the area prospered and bloomed. Even non-Jews had good reason to admire him. Among Jews, his fame reached an unprecedented height. With the added aura of martyrdom, his position was now totally unchallenged. Even the most puritan Hasid couldn't object to his royal privileges. He had paid for them. Even the Kotzke Rebbe, as we said, the uncompromising enemy of all establishments, of all things terrestrial, the fierce and savage seeker of truth, even the Kotzke Rebbe showed him respect and sent messengers to see what is going on in Meseritz, what is going on in Rizhin. One had to be chosen by God to be the victim of the Tsar. A man who spent almost 2 years in prison for nothing had the right to subsequent luxury as a new, unexplored dimension of his suffering. He had to be believed, for he was already loved. So people flocked to him in even larger numbers. They came to bring him their worries and their troubles, their sorrow and their thirst for consolation, for certainty of anything. Not all could speak to him. There were too many. He only received on Friday afternoon, but those who needed to be received were received and guided and consoled. His common sense was so proverbial that he was consulted by famous Gentiles as well, politicians, just like here during the elections. A frequent visitor was Marshal Wittgenstein, who, by the way, never appeared empty-handed. He learned the lesson. He discussed with the Rebbe current affairs and even military strategy. Rich and poor, pious and enlightened, merchants and secular intellectuals, all could be seen in Sadigur before making decisions, any decisions, no matter how important or unimportant. Was the Rishoner considered a miracle maker? No. Rather, a sage, known for his wisdom, not for his mystical powers. He was too modern, too liberal to indulge in miracles, liberal also towards his Hasidim. He permitted them to dress liberally, those who had the means, in a modern way. When told of hooligans who mistreated defenseless Jews in his region, he didn't pray for their safety, but ordered the youth, his youth, to organize groups of self-defense, the first in the Hasidic and perhaps in the Jewish history. He had a clear dislike of the supernatural. His approach to problems was pragmatical. He wanted his Hasidim to be healthy and normal, being himself accustomed to woodcutting and horseback riding. His Hasidim could see the Rebbe, just imagine, horse riding in the morning. But sometimes he would display a sharp and refined sense of humor. Once a man told him, "Rebbe, I would so much like Shuvetun to repent." "Well," said the Rebbe, "why don't you?" "I don't know how," says the Hasid. "Really, you don't know how? Yet you knew how to sin, didn't you?" "Yes," said the Hasid. "First I sinned, then I knew." "Well," said the Rishoner, "do the same the other way around. First repent, you'll know later." Apparently he liked horses, maybe because he wanted to identify with the Baal Shem Tov too much, of whom it is said in tradition that he was the real successor. As you remember, the Baal Shem Tov spoke to the Meseritzer maggot of horses when they first met. Because once the visioner said to a chosid of his, "Look how beautiful, look how magnificent this horse is." He got it as a gift. Do you know why? Because since this horse was born, he never wasted his time with small talk. Another thing, he commented upon the saying of the Pirkei Avot, "Shiyag lachokhma shtika." The way to become wise is to be silent. So he says, if you have a wise man silent and a fool who is silent, how can you distinguish between the two? He said, "Dem chochem artes nit." The wise man is silent, but it doesn't pain him to be silent. Once he said, with some sadness, "Look how ugly this world can be. Artistic creations are honored, cherished, and so expensive, while man, God's creation, is rolling in dust, and his life is so cheap." Once he said, and this is a very beautiful sentence, "It is not the beauty of the sound in the forest that is miraculous. It is not the beauty of the lightning that is miraculous either. It is man's ability to perceive the beauty in the forest and the lightning that is miraculous." And he also had a very prophetic sentence. I think he said it when he was in jail. He said, when the Messiah will come, he will have to come first to save Russian Jewry. Reb Meirl Premishlaner, his friend and admirer, once sent him an urgent letter with an urgent question. As you all know, one is supposed to eat on the Shavuot holiday, I think in English it's Pentecost or something like that, you are supposed to eat kreplech, that everybody knows what it is. So the Meirl Premishlaner asked, how many kreplech should one eat? One is not enough. Three may be too many. And two is not recommended because all even numbers come from unholy spheres. Vosje Tutman, what does one do? And the reasoner had a solution. I quote, "One would be enough, provided it be as large as two." As a practical man, and he was a practical man with practical advice for everybody, he taught his Hasidim not to waste the possible for the impossible, not to sacrifice reality for dreams, not to give up immediate gains for unattainable rewards. He wanted them to help each other rather than aspire to redeem people they can never redeem. He wanted them to rise one step above the ground rather than walk on clouds. He wanted them to keep the means as pure as the end. Perhaps more, because it is more difficult. Occasionally, he would illustrate his ideas with tales about men lost in the woods, their task being to first get back to the outside world and not try to correct it before while still lost in the woods. His favorite parable, here it is. I quote, "A man is lost in the forest. It is dark. Danger lures behind every tree. Suddenly a storm shatters the silence. The imbecile looks at the lightning, the wise man at the road illuminated by it." Rabbi, said one Hasid, I have so many worries, my heart is so broken that I cannot study Torah. And the reasoner answered him, and who tells you that God wants your studies rather than your broken heart? Asked how to worship God without lying to oneself, he replied, I'll tell you how. First, imagine you are the acrobat walking a rope across an abyss. In order to keep your balance, what do? When your body pulls to one side, you pull to the other. Second, what you are forbidden to do, don't do. What you are allowed to do, wait a moment before doing it. Eloquent and incisive always, he knew how to smile at others, with others, and probably that was his greatness and his attraction. And occasionally he even knew how to laugh at himself. The Talmud, he says, compares the Yetzer Hara, the evil spirit, to Melech Zakeinu Psil, an old foolish king. I quote now, he says, I understood why he is compared to a king. He rules over man's passions. Why old? Because he is older than man himself. But why a fool? This I understood, said the visioner, finally, when I was in prison. He was with me, even there. So I told him, fool that you are, I am here, Mele, I have no choice, but you? He did not like the Rambam, Maimonides. First, because Maimonides was a philosopher, and philosophy was not the visioner's strongest subject. And second, let me quote, why I don't like Maimonides. Actually, I should like him, for he does refute Aristotle's theories. But imagine Jews like myself, simple Jews, who would read Aristotle's theories in Maimonides' work, and would fall asleep before they were refuted. Like all Hasidic masters, of course, he believed in God's presence everywhere. You know, this is the cornerstone of Hasidism, that God, let atar panui minei, God is everywhere. There is even one, I think it was Rabbi Nachman who said, if God is everywhere, how do you explain atheism? How can God be an atheism? And the answer is, there is one mitzvah, one commandment, when one should not rely too much on God. That is the mitzvah of tzedakah, of charity. If a poor man comes to get something from you, don't say God should help you. You help him. But the reasoner attacked this problem with, again, exquisite humor. He said, even the Rashaim, even the wicked ones, obey him. Fortunately for them, they are not aware of this. Otherwise, geplatzt wollten sie von Chaos. They would die of spite and anger. Yet, despite his sharp repartees and quick mind, he lost 3 verbal duels. The first to defeat him was a smuggler, the man who carried him on his shoulders across the border when he fled Russia. In the middle of the night, while crossing the river, the smuggler, the Jewish smuggler, stopped and said, Rabbi, if you want me to continue, you better promise me right now a place in paradise. And the reasoner understood, this was no time to argue.
The second oratory defeat occurred during the engagement ceremony of his son with the daughter of Repair Shrimanova. In the presence of numerous prestigious guests and thousands of admirers, the Rizhner turned to his future in-law and said, I quote, it is the custom among Mechutonim to recall their ancestors. Well, know that my grandfather was Reb Abraham Malach, the saint, the angel among men. His father was the celebrated Maggid of Meseritz, who himself was a direct descendant of Yehuda Hanasi, Yohanan Hasantlar, and King David in person. And you, then, women of a rabbi, where do you come from? Oh, I am neither son nor grandson of a rabbi, answered Reb Herschel Rimenova. My father was a simple tailor, poor but honest. He did not teach me the mysteries and splendors of the Zohar. He didn't even teach me Talmud. He had to work for a living. I had to do my own studying. He did teach me something else, in tailoring. Never to spoil what is new and always to mend what is old. And the Rizhner smiled and kept silent. The third episode opposed him to his friend, Reb Meir Penislana. They met on the road while traveling. Reb Meir sat in his modest little wagon drawn by a weak horse, while the Rizhner, as usual, was seated in a sumptuous carriage drawn by four horses exuberant with vigor. The Rizhner felt that was too much, and he felt he should explain, apologize. Clever he was, so he said, I need these horses to pull me out of the mud, just in case. Oh, I understand. Yes, Meirel understands, said the Premislanov tzaddik, always referred to himself really modestly in the third person. But Meirel has only one horse. Therefore, he must be careful and not enter into the mud. Again, the Rizhner smiled and said nothing. But usually, it was he who had the last word. Some chroniclers maintain he wanted to have the last of all words, meaning he really wanted to be the Messiah. Did he really see himself in that role? Some remarks from his lips tend to prove that he did. For instance, he said, I quote, all the tzaddikim speak of the coming of the Messiah and pray to the Messiah and do nothing else. I keep quiet. It is like at a wedding. The parents and the relatives are agitated, nervous, noisy. Only the bridegroom stays in the corner and keeps quiet. Another so-called proof is seen in his affinity for brilliance, wealth, luxury, and glory. His taste for royalty is supposedly linked to the Messiah's royal title, the Melech HaMashiach, the King Messiah. If one is to accept this hypothesis, then the Rizhner genuinely believed himself to be the Redeemer for whom mankind was longing since the beginning of creation. I confess my skepticism with regard to this view. The Rizhner was too clever to play such a game. He knew the end of all false messiahs. He knew the danger that go together with these beliefs. It always went wrong. Messiah the real Messiah, probably does not know he is the Messiah, and certainly before the revelation does not behave as the Messiah. That is the beauty of Judaism again, to show that the Messiah is still here among men, and everyone can be, without him knowing it, the Messiah, if not for the whole world, at least for one person. I think, therefore, the Talmud says that one of the things that was created before the universe was created was the name of the Messiah. Only God knows it. Even the Messiah is waiting for the name to be the Messiah. So there isn't a clever, even shrewd, couldn't have thought it. He should have known, he must have known, that the Messiah does not have musicians and court jesters and servants. He is the melody the musicians play. He is the prayer poor men cannot even formulate if they are too poor and too miserable. The Messiah does not covet honors and golden dishes. How then is one to comprehend his parable about the wedding? I think that the reasoner's role in it is not of the bridegroom, but of an honored guest. He saw himself that when the Messiah will come, of course he will be bound to the chabodim of the honored guest. Who else? So more than many tzaddikim, probably more than all of them, he spoke about the Messiah. One could easily affirm, having studied the entire Hasidic literature, that Hasidism, as conceived and elaborated fervently, in religion, was more Messiah intoxicated than anywhere else. Perhaps it is because the Rishoner, the last of the early masters, sensed that only the Messiah could save the next generations of Jews from their tragic destiny. Therefore, he attempted to hasten his coming. The sooner, the better. His failures show not his limitations, but his aspirations. He was literally obsessed with the coming of the Messiah. He believed man to be worthy of such an event. And like the Spoller Zeide, likely the Yitzhak Berditcheva, he took sides in God's quarrels with man, and he took the side of man and acted as his spokesman before God. One day he explained, Ribono shel Olam, Master of the Universe, it is written, V'mishpatecha amdu hayom ki hakol avadecha, meaning we all stand in judgment before you to be judged. No. In my book, said the visioner, it reads as follows. We ask you to be judged, since it is because of you that we suffer. It is because of us being thy servants that we endure so much suffering. It is also written, he said, Umitne chataenu galinu meachtenu, meaning we were expelled from our country as a result of our sins. And he cried out, no, exile preceded the sins, so you must bring us back. Furthermore, he continued, I swear to you, Master of the Universe, I swear that only the coming of the Messiah could bring, would bring repentance. Then why wait? What's the use? Another time on Rosh Hashanah, he explained, God, be our Father and we shall be thy servants. We shall be thy servants. only if you are our Father. Yes, he addressed God in tones reminiscent of the Berditseva, though with less humility. I think here, too, it's a mark of his greatness. Like the Berditseva, and in a way like Rabbi Nachman, he wanted probably to prove something. He wanted to prove that man can fulfill himself, of course, with God, even against God, provided it is for the community, but not without God, not outside of God. I'm sure that this is why he, who had less reasons than the Berditseva, because he knew less. The Berditseva was a genius in Talmud and Halakha. That's the reason why he opposed God. But he opposed him in his usual princely, quasi-arrogant manner. He said, I can pray to God whenever I will, whenever I want, because I am not a slave who comes to ask favors of the king. I come as an advisor to discuss matters of state. Another time, he was heard to murmur, Ribono shel Olam, how many years do I know you? How many decades? So I'm asking you, is that the way to rule your world? It's high time to have mercy on your people. If you don't listen to me, then tell me, what am I doing on this earth? And another time, still he shouted with pain, why is the Messiah so late in coming? Does he think the next generations will be better, worthier? I tell him here and now that he is wrong. They will be much worse, so much worse. In parentheses, I was in Paris 2 years ago speaking about Rabbi Nachman. Next day, I got a phone call from a man who says, my name is Professor Epstein from Jerusalem. Can I come and see you? And I said, of course. When he came, I was ashamed because he was an old man, and for nothing on earth would I have made him come. I would have gone to him. He came with the Gemara under his arm, and he said, I simply came to correct the mistake you made in quoting the Mamar Chazal. And I felt so humble. And then he says that he's teaching Gemara in France, in Belgium, he's going around, he's teaching. And he says, you know, my disciples now, those disciples that I have, are such a mess. They are so ignorant that once I wanted, in the middle of my course, to close the book and say to God, Ribono shel Olam, Master of the Universe, the tzaddikim of Belz you didn't want, the kedeshim you didn't want, the learned scholars of Lite you didn't want, the musarniks of Slobodka you didn't want, to help this midi. Keep them. There is in a false here really, I think, foresaw what was coming ahead, the decadence of history, the dehumanization that is taking place nowadays. With his tragic sensitivity, he decoded the future. He knew what to expect, so what was coming. The world was running towards destruction. Man would lose his faith. Man would lose his justification on earth. This order was to be of cosmic magnitude, and so was guilt. In his visions, he saw the Acharit Hayamim, the end of time. Good and evil would have the same effects and the same roots. It would be impossible to distinguish dust from dawn, silence from words, and words from truth, and truth from fear, and fear from itself. He was a tragic figure, for he sensed the futility of his endeavors. A day will come, he said, when ignorance will reign. Mediocre men will feel at ease on earth and above, while spiritual people, learned people, men with feelings and conscience will be alienated. The most pious Jew will not be able to recite a chapter of the Psalms. I tell you this, he said, so you will know that's how it should be, for that's how it will be if we do not do anything now to prevent it. Another prediction, horrifying. A day will come when all peoples will begin hating Jews, I'm quoting. They will hate them so much, with such passion, that the Jews will have no choice but go to the land of their ancestors, and that, woe unto us, they to uns, he says, will be the beginning of redemption. We will need them to make us Jews. Once he explained why he refused to intercede in heaven for childless parents, although he did enjoy to unite people in matrimony. He was a perfect chatzman, matchmaker. I quote, from the next century on, the souls sent down to earth will be so horrible, so ugly, and so vulgar, I must say it in Yiddish, after the giant mis se unzukupen. The sight will be unbearable. So he said, one must accept what is given, but pray to get it. No. He was a clever man. He had some intuitive wisdom and brilliance. He didn't leave much writings. He didn't have much. But everything he left is like a jewel. A jewel sometimes painful, like a raw jewel, and brilliant. I quote, a day will come, he meant before the Messiah will come, when man will stop hating others and begin to hate himself. He also said, a day will come when nothing will be coherent. There will be no relationship between man and his faith, desire and dream. There will be no relationship between the Mashal and the Nimshal, meaning between question and answer. The most tragic of his visions is contained in the following tale. A young Hasid of the great Maggid of Meseritz married the daughter of a fiery Mishnagid. It always happened there, this intermarriages. But the father-in-law made him take an oath and choose between Meseritz and his wife. The young man was in love, so he swore he would stay home. But after a while, the Hasid, white Hasid, sick with nostalgia, he ran away to Meseritz. Upon his return, his father-in-law took him to the local rabbi and asked him to sit in judgment. The rabbi consulted the Shulchan Aruch, the code, and pronounced the verdict. Having broken his promise, the culprit must divorce his wife. Soon after, the young Hasid fell sick. He was hungry, he had nowhere to go and sleep and eat. And he died in the street. Well, continued the reasoner, when the Messiah will come, the young Hasid will file a complaint at Intere against his father-in-law and the local rabbi, both guilty of his premature death. His father-in-law will say, I obey the rabbi. The rabbi will say, I obey the Shulchan Aruch. And the Messiah will say, the father-in-law is right, he obeyed the rabbi. The rabbi is right because he obeyed the Shulchan Aruch. And the Shulchan Aruch of God is always right. But then he will embrace the young Hasid and say, what business do I have with them? I come to the ungerecht, to those who are not right. The messianic idea and dream, so deeply rooted in Judaism as a dream and as waiting, was so deeply rooted, all pervasive in the visioner, that he or his son, the Rebbe Moshe Torkover, opinions vary on that, he or his son prepared a special room called Chadar HaMashiach, the room of the Messiah. All the precious objects were stored there, and no one was allowed inside. But the visioner died without welcoming the Messiah. He was sad and weary. He knew he was going to die. He was ready and prepared. He didn't protest. Not much is known about his last moments. Much is known about the way his son, with Nochim of Stefanes, departed. We know that several hours before his final agony, that Nochim washed, put on his Shabbat clothes, went to bed, and asked his friends to sing Grishiner melodies. And he sang with them, and sang, and sang, and sang, until he died. The Grishiner had more time to get ready. On the eve of his last Yom Kippur, he stopped at the entrance of the synagogue, put his hand on the mezuzah, and murmured, Yehirat Zon, may the will be, as Irzol Zayin Akapore Par Klal Yisrael. May I expiate in sacrifice for the entire household of Israel. He died 1 month later. He was 54. 120 years after the event, the character appears more puzzling than during his lifetime. His habits, his charisma, his taste for decorum, and perhaps showmanship remain a mystery to students like me who believe in his greatness, and I do believe in his greatness. It's hard to believe that he loved luxury for the sake of luxury. True, he was no great philosopher or teacher, but he was great as a person, as a leader. Too great to love wealth just for its own sake. All reports testify to that. His ambitions, I believe, were not material ones. I believe he aspired to prove something else, to defy somebody. What and whom? No one knows. Perhaps he wanted no one to know. Perhaps he chose to create his own mystery through luxury. Just as we don't understand the demented mortifications of the Kotzke, the rebelling fantasy of Reb Nachman Bratzlawer, we cannot grasp the meaning of the visionary aristocracy. That he didn't want riches for himself, that is clear. An austere master such as Reinhold Sanzer said, the visionary is ready every moment to sacrifice himself for Klal Israel. Upon close analysis, one realizes that the reasoner always thought in terms of collective experiences in historic and trans-historic categories. Perhaps he tried to console and comfort his poor Hasidim in showing them that Galut Israel, the exile, the reality of exile, does not exclude the dream of Malchut Israel, the dream of redemption. Perhaps he tried to offer them a refuge inside that exile, just as the Talmud for 2,000 years was a refuge inside persecutions. I believe that what kept Judaism for 2,000 years is the Talmud. Outside there were slaughtering Jews. And 5 steps from them, here in the room, there were Jews studying such irrelevant or apparently irrelevant questions about Bates and all the beyond it. That was the strength and that was the shield of the Jewish people for 2,000 years. Perhaps he wanted to provide another shield. Perhaps he wanted to remind them that malchut, royalty, is also an attribute to God. That the form is also part of reality and of trans-reality just as the content is. Perhaps he wanted to remind them and him that the God of Israel is also the King of Israel, whose dispersed and destroyed kingdom remains, must remain indestructible. Perhaps he wanted to emphasize the warning of the Baron Karliner, who said, as you remember, we are all princes, and to forget that is the greatest sin of all. It is also possible that he had still higher aspirations for justification. In artistic terms, renunciations contains a certain joy, provokes a certain kind of ecstasy that no possession could offer. Is it possible then that a reasoner chose luxury out of despair, or rather to attain despair? That he had aspired to go beyond all limits, beyond the limits of his belief and find poverty within plenitude, sadness within joy, and joy again of an entirely different nature and substance within that sadness. Is it conceivable that he came to the realization that he would never resemble his ancestors and therefore chose to be rich and show them that he could nevertheless be like them, one of them? Although he had more obstacles to overcome, he would be as great as them. That despite appearances, he was on their level. And that appearances have their own secret. Is that why he spoke so often of the Messiah? To bring an end to all appearances. All these are hypotheses. And I would like to say yes to all these because I, as a business associate, would like to defend the reasoner and believe in him in everything he did. But for me, the reasoner remains a mystery. I am bothered by his supersensitivity on one hand and his excessive self-indulgence on the other. It is too easy to say that it is easy to suffer in misery. That it is more difficult to be alone inside a crowd, humble and famous, poor, wild, rich. Only rich people can say that. Instinctively, I am suspicious of material rewards accompanied by alibis. The scenery may influence both the action and the characters on stage. Means can and do influence the end. Every game runs the risk of ultimately defining itself by its own rules. How then is one to make out the reasoner? I would like to see him as a tragic visionary, cursed with a gift to view things with painful clarity. He knew he was the last of a line. He knew that after him, Hasidism would no longer be the same. That later Hasidim would have the leaders they deserve and would inherit a world which would not deserve them. He also knew, he must have known, that it is not enough. Unfortunately, and that is a tragedy of man's life and endeavor, it is not enough to call upon the Messiah to make him come.
Thanks for listening. For more information on 92nd Street Y and all of our programs, please visit us on the web at 92y.org. This program is copyright by 92nd Street Y.